Now, the last gentleman in the well, a Republican, I guess, quoting my wife again, has a revolving door on his closet. He's in, he's out, he's in, he's out, he's in. Now, I guess you're out because you went up and spoke to a huge homosexual dinner last week, Mr. Gunderson, or week before last, if I read the papers correctly. If I don't, correct me.
Mr. Chairman, I think this conversation is out of order and has no place.
3 years ago.
The charged comments you just heard, outing GOP Representative Steve Gunderson of Wisconsin, were preceded by debate over an anti-homosexuality amendment to a 1994 education funding bill.
Clerk will report the amendment.
An amendment offered by Mr. Hancock of Missouri, page 762, after line 8, insert the following. Section 9508, prohibition against funds for homosexual support. A. Prohibition, no local educational agency that receives funds under this act shall implement or carry out a program or activity that has either the purpose or effect of encouraging or supporting homosexuality as a positive lifestyle alternative. B. Definition.
Representative Gunderson rose to question the sponsor of the amendment, fellow GOP Representative Mel Hancock of Missouri, over how the amendment might affect the well-being of gay students.
Would counseling in the school between a certified school counselor and a student on that student's struggle for their personal identity be considered a program or activity under your amendment?
Counseling them for the purpose of the counseling that we have here of homosexuality as a positive, affirmative lifestyle, yes, I think that would be prohibited.
Okay, let me take that one bit further. There is a recent study out, I think it was actually a study by the Department of Health and Social Services under the Bush administration, a 1989 report of the Secretary of Health and Social Services Task Force on Youth Suicide that found that, quote unquote, homosexuals were 2 to 6 times more likely than heterosexuals to attempt suicide. Now, this happened under the Bush administration. What happens if a kid is found in the lunchroom or in the restroom attempting suicide and it's discovered in they take it to the high school counselor, and the high school counselor says, let's talk. And the kid says, I think I'm a homosexual. Can that counselor respond in a way that encourages that young person to accept themselves as a human being? Will that be have the effect of, quote unquote, promoting homosexuality?
I believe under those circumstances that you described, the proper procedure for a school official would be to refer that student to an individual with the credentials that Mr. McDermott from Washington has to
So you are saying that under your amendment, no school guidance counselor in America would be able to counsel a student, boy or girl, who came to them and said, I'm really struggling with who I am.
I think that they could counsel them. I question whether we have very many people in public education that are qualified to counsel on this particular subject. I don't know that that's a requirement of a teaching diploma.
Yeah, but remember, none of us wanted to get into teacher certification a couple weeks ago.
But we can counsel, and the proper thing to do, if an individual is not and should recognize that they are not qualified to counsel in this field, they should refer them to the proper counseling experts.
I will yield briefly because I got a lot of questions.
I just want to say, as I read this amendment, of course, a young man who has an ambivalence ought to be counseled. He needs attention, care. But what this amendment proscribes is encouraging or supporting
the homosexual lifestyle, and that's different from giving advice and counsel. Here's the problem that I have with the amendment. I don't know about anybody else, but has the effect of. I mean, if you drop the words, has the effect of, from your amendment, then I think what the gentleman from Illinois is suggesting is clearly palatable. And see, where I'm trying to get you, I hope there isn't a person in America who supports
an academic course in our public or private schools promoting homosexuality. I don't support that. But what I'm trying to deal with is an amendment that goes beyond what I think is that legitimate intention to some very destructive effects. Number one is dealing with counseling. The second one I want to get to is the issue of education. I mean, your amendment says that any school that receives funds under this act cannot use any funds that has the effect of promoting homosexuality under any program or activity. I would assume by that you mean then that AIDS education is no longer an allowed activity in any public school in America if your amendment passes. Because I ask unanimous consent for 5 additional minutes.
Without objection.
Can you respond? I mean, I'm just trying to find out. I think, as I tried to discuss with you some time ago, I think a discussion can lead us to a consensus on this amendment that gets where you want to go, that doesn't have the negative effects that I fear.
Would the gentleman yield to me?
Sure.
I just again revert to the language of Mr. Hancock's amendment. It says, shall implement or carry out a program or activity that has either the purpose, and I know the words that trouble you, or effect, now, of encouraging or supporting homosexuality as a positive lifestyle alternative. I think that fits what the gentleman himself has said is not a provident thing.
So you do not believe then that if this amendment is adopted, that AIDS education will in any way be limited?
Not at all. I would hope it wouldn't be. And I would hope a young person struggling with their own identity could get counseling under this amendment, so long as the lifestyle of homosexuality is not encouraged. It's not encouraged. That doesn't mean it has to be misunderstood or condemned or judgmental, but just not to promote, encourage it as a positive lifestyle. That's all.
Okay. Question number three. What happens, what's the enforcement effect of your amendment? We discussed this yesterday with the Doolittle Amendment as well. Let's assume a school is found to have violated your amendment. What's the penalty?
That is a, since the question was brought up yesterday, we've done a little research, and we find that the Department of Education, when they receive applications for federal funds from schools, that the schools swear to uphold the laws under this, under the various laws.
So they have to sign a report ahead of time proving that they're not doing anything of this sort.
That's correct. And they also swear to uphold the rules and regulations, the mandates, if you want to call it that, the other 23 of the Department of Education. So those funds could be removed if, in fact, they didn't abide by the law.
Okay, let me further ask you another question, and I regret this is taking a lot of time, but the Reagan AIDS Commission listed 3 recommendations regarding education on AIDS in the school system. One of them required states' board of education should mandate that an HIV education curriculum be developed that is student age sensitive. Our recommendation was that local school boards should do the same thing, and third recommendation was that school boards and parents should develop a means to incorporate values emphasizing personal responsibility. How would those recommendations of the Reagan AIDS Commission be affected by your amendment?
Were those recommendations made to promote, to encourage and support homosexuality as an alternative lifestyle? I don't think so.
Well, does it have the effect of?
No.
Are you willing to delete those words?
I think it's just the other way around. I think that AIDS education, properly presented for what it is, but not the type of literature that is being used in our public schools now. This document here.
Okay, running out of time. You're getting off
whatsoever.
The subject. Answer me a question. Would you agree to a unanimous consent request to delete the words or has the effect of?
No.
Why not?
Because it would, here again, it is part of the unsold double.
This has got nothing to do with the unsold amendment. I'm talking about your amendment.
The unsold amendment does do the same thing that you're asking me to do, and no, I would not agree, because that opens up the door for them to say, well, we didn't intend for this to be this way. We didn't intend. It opens up the door for them to get around it by misrepresentation of what they intended to do.
All right, I reclaim my time because I think, ladies and gentlemen, you see the problem.
No matter how good the intentions might be verbally, the problem is if you adopt the Hancock Amendment by itself, it has the effect of prohibiting school counseling and guidance. It has the effect of prohibiting AIDS education. Now, I put myself second to no one in quote-unquote advocating Christian values around here. And I'm aware of the flyer that is here. But I'm going to plead with you all on this amendment to have the courage of your convictions and to recognize that as of January of this year, 63,000 young people between the age of 20 to 29, and most medical people will tell you that means every one of those 63,000 was infected with AIDS while they were teenagers. I ask you simply, how many kids do we have to kill before we have the courage to stand up and say it's time to educate them and to do what is right, not what is politically popular at that moment?
Gentleman, you.
Representative Robert Dornan of California, a conservative, then took the floor to lament changing social values and to challenge Representative Gunderson's position on the amendment.
We've got a decorum in this chamber, and it may be the last sane place in this nation 20 or 30 years from now when our moral standards have culturally melted down to the stands of Sodom and Gomorrah. Look, I was born in Manhattan, and I was raised in Beverly Hills from 10 to 19 when I went in the Air Force, and those two communities have a particular penchant for poisoning Little Dorothy's Kansas or Iowa or other parts of this country. Now, the last Republican, gentlemen, the last Republican for the state of New York or Manhattan?
Mr. Speaker, point of personal privilege. I ask the gentleman to withdraw his comment about my district poisoning the rest of the country.
Ridiculous. Teach him parliamentary
procedure. The gentleman
procedure.
May not assert upon a personal privilege. The gentleman will resume.
Now, the last gentleman in the well, a Republican, I guess, quoting my wife again, has a revolving door on his closet. He's in, he's out, he's in, he's out, he's in. Now, I guess you're out because you went up and spoke to a huge homosexual dinner last week, Mr. Gunderson, or week before last, if I read the papers correctly. If I don't, correct me.
Mr. Chairman, and I think this conversation is out of order and has no place.
3 years ago.
From Michigan, demands that the words be
taken down. Take them down, I'll wait. Sick of this.
The clerk will report the gentleman's words.
After a two-minute pause, Representative Dornan elected to withdraw his statement.
The gentleman from California.
I ask unanimous consent to withdraw my words.
The objection. Without objection, the gentleman's words are withdrawn.
Mr. Speaker, I...
The gentleman from California may resume. The gentleman from Michigan.
Chairman.
From Michigan.
Mr. Speaker,
what purpose,
Mr. Chairman, do I not control the time now?
I'm sorry, I can't give unanimous consent to that. I think the
gentleman's already did.
Words should
be taken down, Mr. Chairman.
And it should be silenced in this chamber.
Parliamentary ruling, already did.
The House has already agreed by unanimous consent to allow the gentleman to withdraw his
words. Mr. Chairman, I'm standing on my feet trying to deal with the people around me. I object to unanimous consent.
A regular order, please, Mr. Chairman.
I insist that the gentleman's words be read and he be silenced for the rest of this debate.
It's my time, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Chairman.
To a vote.
Unfortunately, the gentleman's objection is untimely. May proceed in order.
The Hancock Amendment would pass, along with another amendment, introduced by Democratic Representative Jolene Unsold, severely limiting the ways it could be practically enforced.
The yeas are 301, the nays are 120. The amendment, as amended, is agreed to.
Representative Gunderson voted for both amendments. Though outed as a Republican in a time when LGBT acceptance was low, he was re-elected to a final term in office in November 1994, making him the first openly gay Republican to win a federal election.